A very good day to all of you. My name is Valentin Post. I'm living in the city of Rotterdam and I'm working in The Hague in the Netherlands. I have the privilege to talk to you about a very exciting topic, being financing of sanitation. It's very exciting and also very little understood. Myself, I've been working and living in developing countries for the last 22 years, and I've been working only in the fields of sanitation, wastewater, and solid waste management, and my focus has always been public-private partnerships and financing. When we talk about financing, and that's why I think this assignment or this course is really very appropriate, we tend to think of sanitation, and if you talk to many people in the street or at parties, that sanitation is something with a sewer. And what UNESCO IHC has quite rightly seen is that sewer is not everywhere applicable, and the kind of resources we would need, the kind of human infrastructure and physical infrastructure we would need, the money we would need to construct sewers everywhere, the problems we would have in having so much water for just flushing, make sewer a not really a long-term solution everywhere. So what they are looking at, and that's that I think is very timely, decentralized solutions. And in the decentralized solutions of wastewater and sanitation, one of the issues you still deal with is sanitation, is financing. And in a way you can compare it with the telecom industry. If you look into a country like the Netherlands, everyone has landlines, we have sewer systems, and then going to different countries, let's say in Africa, you go to Kenya. Kenya has little sewer systems, very few landlines, but what you see is they leapfrogged in the telecom industry into the 21st century, but we're all in the 21st century. They leapfrogged ahead of the Netherlands in mobile communication, mobile applications. And why is that? Because they didn't have the sunken investments in fixed telecom assets. Now, comparing this to sanitation, you get actually the same thing. They don't have the fixed assets in sanitation infrastructure. So what it would mean is that they can decentralize, they can leapfrog into the 21st century. So by this I mean to say that not having these things actually can prove to be an advantage. But having said enough about that, let me focus on sustainable financing of sanitation. That's the topic of this keynote address. Now, I'm divided in a couple of different sections. We start with what is actually sustainable financing. What are the sanitation elements? We have chains. I'm going to talk about the diamond model, which has been developed by the BASE, the organization I'm working for. Then we look at the business side, sanitation needs addressed, and product market combinations. You look at the different financial instruments. I would like to share with you two examples and finally some suggestions for further reading. In addition, there will be two films for which you get the links, and I also put in a few questions where you can take some of your time to answer them. So let me start here. What is sustainable financing? The way we see it, we look at sustainable financing, the key word is the local part. Sustainable financing is not really driven by external finance, it's not driven, let's say, by donors, what many people think. No, sustainable financing is the local banks, local financial institutions, local microfinance, local governments, who also have an important role to play, they should be the key. International donors, multilaterals, they can play a facilitating role, but the key in financing is that it should be local. The another part where people should really take care of, that you should start working on business planning. So financing can be mobilized provided there are plans behind it. And these plans are often not there, so they have to be developed. So what are the elements we're looking at? And if you want to develop your plans, you have to look, what am I going to develop them for? So there are different elements. But we look into the five essential elements in a sanitation chain. We look at the toilet itself. The toilet, sometimes called the latrine, a grey water system can be part of it. Then we have some sort of collection system. That collection system can be a pit, can be a septic tank, can be a biogas installation, can be all sort of things. Then you have a conveyance and transport. If you don't have an on-site, completely on-site system, you need a conveyance and transport. If you have a septic tank, the septic tank will need to be emptied. So if that's going to be emptied once in a while, then that has to be conveyed and transported to somewhere. Then where does it go to? Is there, this may go to a treatment plant. At the treatment plant, it's either going to be disposed after treatment, or there are going to be reuse possibilities. In on-site sanitation at household level, you get quite often you have combinations of these. So a toilet with a double leach pit also has the, it's an on-site treatment system too, and an on-site disposal system. The treatment takes place in interaction between the bacteria in the soil and the human excreta. So these are different chains. So we see from the toilets, collection, transport, treatment, disposal, reuse, and we see the service chain, so that's taking the products away from the user, and then you see another chain, which we call the value chain, which actually go on the other side. So we look at the reuse, disposal, treatment, collection, and transport. Now here actually are the first questions. Please take some time to think about it. The first question is, what could these arrows mean? So if you remember, the service chain had an arrow going this side and the value chain went the other side. Then secondly, if you look into the value chain, the second question, in the value chain there is a broken, partially broken arrow. What would that mean? What could that indicate? So the service and value chains in sanitation. Just to give you a few pictorial examples, number one is the toilets, or actually rather the absence of toilets. Then you have different type of toilets. This is a urine diversion toilet, and this has been designed by an NGO, as you can see. This one is a low water, very low water usage toilet, but this has been done by a real company. So it looks shiny, it looks good, it looks appealing. The collection and transport of human fecal matter, this being collected by hand, the manual collection, and this is mechanical. Of course, there are a lot of health issues here, but this is also the practice. This happens. People were saying it doesn't happen in my country. They should get out and at night and see what's happening there. The pits have to be emptied once they're full, and quite often you don't have access. Then there are different type of small machines. This is one, a local assembled vehicle, which we did actually in Mali, in Western Africa. And you have the bigger trucks. And I always like this one. To you it may be shit, but for us it's bread and butter. Then you have certain treatment sites. This is from Sri Lanka, where fecal sludge was being treated. The site was a little bit in disuse. But the idea is there. This is a new site in India. These are the public toilet blocks, and they go into a biogas system. And that's under, under commissioning. Reuse is an example from China. where they, from the wastewater, they get the pellets. The pellets are being applied there on the tobacco land. That's part of the same farm. And we have an example which I talk more about later in India. Also fecal sludge is used to generate a product. Right. So when we talk about the urban sanitation system, how do we build sustainable systems? So if we start from the consumer side, the household, the family, whatever it is, the school, the institution, we need to first create awareness and generate demand. So that's the first part. And for this we have a lot of communication campaigns, social marketing, there are a lot of different tools with different organizations. Product and service development. So we may need to improve on whatever is there. The products which are there may be good or may not be so good, so they may have to be tweaked a little bit. Services may be there, may be perfect, may be imperfect. What you find a lot here in the implementation part is the use of, again, of mobile technology. People calling them there, their pit is full, private sector responding. This really helps in getting services moved much faster. Then we go into the consumption and use. So we have, this is very obvious in solid waste. Whatever product you have, let's say a newspaper, you read your newspaper, you throw it out. And that has a value, there's always a value in paper. Human waste is not so different, really. There is some value, it's not much, but there's some value in human waste. There are nutrients in it, there's carbon in it, so that can be used. The consumption, of course, we don't really consume it. We consume other things, and this is the waste product remaining. The logistics we talked about earlier, it has to go from A to B. There will be transport facilities behind it. Then the treatment and disposal. Quite often you can't, human excreta contains a lot of pathogens, so it's not ready for immediate reuse, you need to treat it first. Wastewater, which can be also from sanitation, needs to be treated, and quite often it's disposed. It's used, for instance, to recharge aquifers. But then you also have the product reuse, and that's what I was talking about earlier. In human waste, you find some carbon and you find nutrients. So what you find is nitrogen and phosphorus mainly. And those products can be used in agriculture or can be used in renewable energy. So if you look into an urban sanitation system, who are the main stakeholders and how can you determine that? So what we have developed over the years, over the last, I would say, 20, 25 years perhaps, is what we called later on the diamond. We didn't call it a diamond earlier, we had different terms for this model, but today we call it a diamond. So what is this diamond model? So we have on the top side, we have the households, the families. We have the financial institutions on the right-hand side, the business environment, businesses, SMEs, large-scale business on the left-hand side, and the local government at the bottom side. Now, all these interact in different ways. What we, on the top side, you have households. Households, once awareness is created, demand is generated, financial institutions are linked to them, then this demand becomes effective. Once the demand is effective, then it becomes interesting for businesses to start supplying to households. Businesses themselves are interested to have finances from the institutes to grow for liquidity financing, for working capital. So there's a clear link between those two. And this top part we call the business environment. Then the local government plays a key role also in all sanitation provisions. What do? They regulate, they monitor. It's our opinion they shouldn't do too much in the implementation itself, but they should really be monitoring the whole system, how it works, how it operates. And they also have typically a responsibility for the vulnerable people in the society. So not all households would be eligible to get, for instance, financing from banks. So this is where governments can play a role, local governments. But how the diamond works, instead of me talking to you, I thought it's better maybe you see it on a short film. So please take some time. It's about a 3-minute film on how this diamond works in practice. So one of the underlying is that the polluter pays. And is that really, really the case? I wonder. In the diamond model, we are talking about the vulnerable. There's a responsibility for the local government or the government to care for the vulnerable in society. But who are they? So typically what we look at from the outside, you have the rich people who of course can take care of themselves and the vulnerable. But is it really such a division or not? If you look again into the mobile telecom industry, you look at the amount of people having a telephone in developing countries, a television set and a toilet, then is it really a question of money? Are these people as vulnerable as we think they are? Do they have so limited capacities to pay for services and goods as we often assume they are in case of sanitation or other public infrastructure? Looking at the telephone spread under within society and looking at the number of televisions, then you may wonder, is this really the case? So who are these vulnerable? If we take the original thinking, you have the rich and the vulnerable, but then if you start looking into who are these vulnerable, you have salary workers, you have a lot of informal sector workers, and indeed you still have some vulnerable. So the care of the local government or the government should not be on the entire group, should be on a much smaller percent, which is again more manageable for them. Still going to be very difficult, no doubt. It's going to be more manageable, and for these there will be different financial institutions and instruments which can cater to their needs. So now let's look into, we've covered now the diamond model, let's look into the business side of sanitation. And that I would like to take you through something which is a product market combination. So if we look into sanitation itself, we look into what are the needs actually we are addressing. What are the elements and what is it, how can this be described? So, privacy and convenience, safety and comfort. That's being addressed by what? By a toilet. Now, what kind of toilet can we have? Household toilet construction, household toilets, public toilets, community toilets. So, in the privacy, convenience, safety and comfort sphere, we talk about toilets. That's a sanitation element from the chain. If we think about bad smell or overflow, again, that's a toilet collection and transport. That can be, what are the elements? That can be a integrated system, or it can also be a sewer system, small-scale sewer system, simplified sewer. That can also be the emptying we talked about. That can be manual, mechanical, and then of course the transport to another place. Excreta removal. That is on the treatment disposal side. Again, it's about emptying and transport. If we want to see agriculture inputs, then we come in the sanitation element, we come into the reuse. We talk about fertilizers, compost, enrichment. We can even talk about more exciting new technologies emerging, fish feed and wastewater reuse. Renewable energy again comes from the reuse sphere. Remember, there is a carbon source in human excreta, so biogas, briquettes, and you can also start feeding, for instance, cement kilns. The last public and public health or environmental health, that's the entire system. So everything works together here, and this deals with all the different elements. Now, how can you, taking this, so your assignment would be, and please take a couple of minutes, what do you think could be based on this potential product market combination? So what could be the product, what could be the market, and how can you find in the sanitation service and value chain what kind of different product market combinations can you find? This may take you up to maybe 10 minutes, maybe less. If you're very fast, you can do it much faster. And if you want to take more time, be my guest, think about it, and I'm sure you'll come up with some very interesting ideas and possibilities. And it's also a field wherein some things have happened and a lot has still to happen. So maybe your ideas will be the future course of action. Who knows? So now, when it comes back from our side, what are we looking at? We are looking at different product market combinations. We look at household toilets, the construction part. Now, who's doing that? These are typically micro, small, and medium enterprises. Seldom do you find very large-scale enterprises in big sanitation drives. And who are these? Who are actually doing the work? That's the artisans, the masons. You have people in construction, in plumbing. Masons are often assisted by helpers. So in the entire construction business, you have a lot of employment. Then you have the material suppliers. A toilet comprises of different elements: pipes, vents, slabs, doors, roofs. So they are all supplied by someone. They're manufactured and supplied by someone. But also you're using cement, you're using bricks. Then you have aggregators. This is a fairly new concept to many, but if you have a confirmed demand for, let's say, 500 or 5,000 sanitation systems, if you have that demand confirmed, and remember we talked about creating awareness, generating demand, and linking it to finances. So making the demand effective. Now, if you have that for a certain area, then it becomes interesting to start aggregating the demand and start going for bulk purchases. If you go for bulk purchases, and everyone knows when you go to a shop, that's what you do. If you buy one or you buy 10, you start asking for discounts. This works the same thing in the business world. So if you have big purchases, confirmed purchases, you can get a lot of benefits which you won't get today. This can be in form of timely delivery, it can be in form of discounts, cash discounts, it can even be in the form of credits. So in one of our programs in India, you've been able to get credits instead of delivery payment on delivery. We have a 30-day credit. We have been able to get discounts of 15% to 20% on top of that. And it's also possible, this is something which is slowly emerging, MSMEs can be organized under a franchise. The next one I would say is a different product market combination that's now really at the financing side. So who could this be? This could be microfinance institutions starting to offer sanitation loans. It could be housing finance. Sanitation is part of a house. So housing finance institutions are slowly taking this up. But also if you look into impact investors, there's a lot of talk these days about impact investors. Those are, let's say, organizations sitting quite often abroad. But how do they really achieve impact? So how can they, again, tell their shareholders we're doing impact? If they refinance, for instance, MFIs or housing finance, and they build sanitation assets, that can be put in the annual reports, and the impact investors can show to their shareholders, look, we're doing impact investing. But there's also another way, is demand generation via local partners. The demand generation is key, because without demand, the whole supply side is not going to work. this is actually for many local CBOs, community-based organization, NGO type of organization, they can do as a business, or let's say microfinance institutions, or for housing finance. And of course you have the regular technical liaison. That's of consulting companies, sometimes NGOs are taking on that role. That's in the household toilet financing. That's the second product market combination. Number three, and that doesn't come as a surprise for many of you, that's the public toilets. So the public toilets, we look at the hardware part, the CAPEX, and that's quite often, not always, but quite often it's a little difficult to get finances for that. But you do find there's a different ways of financing that part. There are quite a number of examples of CSR, corporate social responsibility financing going. Public financing is also used to a large extent. There are, not too many, but there are some examples that commercial financing is going to the investment cost. And of course self-financing. These are entrepreneurs who have an idea, this is what we are going to do. And they raise their own money and they build these. Now, typically the operational cost, even if this is externally financed, quite often they run on a pay-per-use system. But what you do see is the more entrepreneurial public toilet operators, they start offering other services. A bathing is one. But you see, if you go to Kenya, you find often in the public, they have rental for shoe polishing. In India, it's a phone recharge, and quite often they all use advertisement. If you have a public toilet in a very nice locality in the city center, this is a prime area for advertisement. So on your public toilet, the superstructure, you can put advertisement and get paid for it. There are from India, there's a very exciting IT-based model that is under development. It's running now at, I think, 30 or 40 public toilets. But what is a main bottleneck with many of these is that the licenses to operate are given by the local authority and they're quite often not long-term. And that makes it very difficult for any investor to put money there. Because you would need to get your money back. You can't get it from a public toilet within a year. There is an example, and that's actually the reverse. Where instead of you paying for a toilet, when you go there, the toilet complex pays you. And this is in Musi, southern India, where for every time you pee there, you get 10 paise. Now, 10 paise is not a whole lot of money, but the idea is that you actually produce a resource that then later on they can use in agriculture. Now, coming to the product market combination 4, that's the mechanical collection and transport. You've seen the pictures already. This is a very clear revenue model. This for everyone, for a bank, it's very easy to understand. A household calls someone, they come, you pay them, and they empty your tank, your pit, whatever it is. There are many, many, many examples from different countries. I think if you look around, if you think about what you all see, you see water tankers, but you also see sludge or sewage tankers. And you can only hope that they don't mix the two, that your sludge tank is not used for providing water. The main bottleneck in these is that there's a lack of disposal sites. So you empty it, then where do you bring it to? And quite often, if there are no proper disposal sites, you have to dispose it in not the best of all places. For instance, it's quite often disposed alongside river canal, rivers, canals, empty land. And it's another bottleneck is again the license part. This makes it you're not always licensed to operate. If you have no license, then the financing you won't be able to get bank financing or any financing at all. But if you're short-term license, then again for a bank, they start looking twice. So they have a similar bottleneck as public toilets. The manual collection and transport, again, it's a clear revenue model. The pit is full, the tank is full, you call and they come. It happens everywhere, but it's not very visible. You really have to look for it, you have to ask, and you find out who they are, and they operate quite often also at night. Well, the health is of course a main bottleneck. People make money, but at what cost? But they also have the transport and disposal. You empty it, and then what are you going to do with it? Where are you going to take it to? Where are you going to dispose it? On the positive side, these guys actually make money. I've seen these guys. I haven't heard or seen, no, it's 100% true. There are some women doing it as well. But by and large, these are men going into the pits. The women are more involved in the transport part. There is a film on this, not only on this, but also on mechanical emptying. And I would like you to see that, perhaps at the end of the keynote presentation. What I would advise you, make sure you're seated very well, you have a strong stomach, but it's worth it. It really proves this is what the reality. It also tells you how people are having different looks at it when they come from different backgrounds. Then the treatment and reuse, that's also a clear product market combination. Biogas, compost and compost enrichment, treated wastewater use in reuse and irrigation, fertilizer, from urine you can produce the struvite, and land application of fecal matter. So there are a number of possibilities. Many of them are still emerging. So the let's say the cost and the revenues don't always add up yet. But we're getting there. Now, all these different product market combinations, underlying them are different instruments. So we have different financial instruments to make them viable, to make them also interesting for financial institutions, because not all of them have the same demand for financing, the same liquidity demands, can offer the same returns. But there are a range of financial instruments, and it's quite often now a matter of choice. Talk to the right financial institution, talk about the right financial instrument, and the match can be made. So if you look into the sphere of the smaller financing, the microfinance, there are microfinance itself is often being simplified to microcredit. Well, that's not really the case. Microfinance in its true form always starts with financial literacy. You're offering a financial product to someone, and they have to understand what it is that you're offering them. So the part, we call it financial literacy. So if you offer a credit, if you offer a savings product, if you offer a micro pension, they have to understand. That's compulsory, but it's also part of your relation with your client. If you don't do that properly, then your client may feel that they're taken for a ride, and the loyalty towards your institution will be very minimal. So there is an intrinsic need from the MFIs, the good solid MFIs, microfinance institutions, to make sure that they have proper financial literacy program. Then we have microcredit as another financial product, micro savings, micro insurance, micro pensions. And all of these are, we call them micro because the ticket size, the size of the savings, the size of the credits, it's all small. If you look into the different elements, so what are the most relevant? I talked about financial literacy. Microcredit, I think, is pretty obvious. Then in many particularly African countries, savings and credits are linked. So you get saving and credit groups. So you first need to save, then you can take your credit. In India, the self-help groups have a similar sort of mechanism. They can actually then come into a next financial instrument. They can go to a bank, and it's called the Bank Self-Help Group Linkage Program. Then there are other joint liability groups. They are a little similar, but different from self-help groups. Table banking, individual microfinance, and merry-go-rounds. Merry-go-rounds is an interesting model where actually there's no interest being paid. You all deposit something, and at the end of the year or 1.5 years, it's your turn to take all the money which everyone has put in. And it helps you overcome your liquidity problems or to do some investment, and then every month you start putting your money into the same pool again. There are other types of finance which are outside the microspheres. That's the impact investing, which can be done also into microfinance. There are local government subsidies. Quite often they are there in the sanitation field because it's a public good, so you also find public investment. Then there are first and second loss financial instruments. They're quite often used for microfinance, and they can be provided externally. Cooperative financing, that's a very interesting one. Quite often, if you look into, let's say, dairies, dairy cooperatives, they raise quite a bit of money. Their members are being paid through milk, the milk they sell, and it's possible that the cooperative actually starts organizing for, let's say, sanitation. That's the topic of this lecture. If they pay for sanitation, it can be repaid through a deduction on the milk price. And this is something we're doing in India with the AMOL group. Bank financing is, I think, is obvious. Self-financing. You are starting to motivate people to put in their own savings into sanitation. That's what self-financing is about. Then output-based aid and result-based financing. These are financial instruments used by donors. Donors can be external donors, but can also be governments. The big financing schemes, the sanitation schemes in India, are all output-based aid and result-based financing. So you build, once it's there, it's certified, and people have taken a picture, then only the subsidy will flow. That's an output-based aid mechanism. Use of guarantee funds. Now, if you look into we saw the trucks, the trucks which come to empty a pit. What you find is that the bank often they think, well, yeah, they're making money, but I don't know this business at all. So why should I actually put my money? I don't have any experience. I don't know these guys. So what has been our experience, if we put in a guarantee fund in such a financial institution who is willing to start lending to the sector, then they overcome some of these hurdles and actually they start putting their own money into it. We have done this starting in 2003 in Costa Rica, and after 3-4 years we could withdraw our guarantee fund, and the bank decided, well, it's a viable business, it's a good business case, so we don't need the guarantee fund anymore. Another one is the leverage on fixed deposits. Quite often, if you put some money in the bank, then you would be entitled to actually start a loan because you have put something in there. Against that, you can withdraw more money. Corporate social responsibility, that is like a gift, but it's also used for sanitation drives. Suppliers credit, I talked about, that's on aggregation. Equity investments, that is in companies. Co-investments, that can be equity, can be other type of investments. And non-convertible debentures, that has to do with the financial regime. So this is used by impact investors in our sanitation schemes in India. Then we have a revolving fund, that I think is quite clear, small investment facility, a convertible grant, social equity fund. So there are really a range of different financial instruments. What should be an interesting one still to cover? Blended finance. So you can take, let's say, grants, you can blend it with commercial financing, you can get into one lower tariff than the other one. The normal one would be the market-based interest rate, or you can go into more risky investments. All these instruments we have actually used in two of our programs in India and Kenya, and only the last three we're still working on, we're still developing them. That's the sanitation line of credit, the carbon financing, or the, I should say properly, the climate financing, and bond financing. Those three are still under development, and they are interesting because they're very scalable instruments. So what is then the key message is you need to make tailor-made. So you have a product-market combination, you have an entrepreneur, the entrepreneur needs something. Now there are so many different instruments that you have to look what is now going to be the right match, what's going to be the right financial institution offering what kind of product. It's quite often depending on the legal framework. Some institutions are by law not allowed to do certain things, financial institutions. So I want to share with you that, for instance, from Ghana, there are a lot of existing financial products which actually may suit your needs. So there are, they call them, and this is just an example, but it's important, I think, not the figures. What is important, there are products out there. There are products which could actually suit the business. What are banks looking for? They're looking for security. So the first thing they do, forget about all this, they would look, are you going to repay my loan? Am I going to be sure that you repay? That's the first thing they look at. If they get a positive answer on that one, then other things start applying. They start looking at, okay, what are my securities, what money am I going to make, because these are commercial financial institutions, what would be the terms, etc. That's all quite often negotiable. You can see also there's some variations. The tenure of the loan is very important, but it's negotiable. But it's non-negotiable. If you can't repay, that's a non-negotiable. So there has to be a capacity to repay. That's what they're looking at. So what we think in the sanitation sphere would be the most relevant financial instruments, we talk about bank loan and microfinance loan. If you have them in place, a revolving fund mechanism, if they exist, then that's a good mechanism. And the guarantees. There are many types of guarantees. You have personal guarantees, you can have guarantees based on contracts. You have guarantees where you pledge your future cash flows. You have first loss guarantee and second loss guarantee. The line of credit. In some countries there are now sanitation line of credits. And what you find is whoever has given that sanitation line of credit would like that to be utilized. So there is a pressure from the sanitation line of credit provider to the local financial institution that it's being utilized. So this offers opportunities if you have a solid business proposition to go there and get the finances you need. Then the shared guarantees, that's the principle of microfinance. You have suppliers credits, special schemes, and these are different from these. They may be similar as well, but I'm talking here about the Waste Venture Fund. And you have a lot of mixtures of these. So there's really much more out there than perhaps you realize, and there are more opportunities. I just give you two examples where you have a business and now how can this be financed?
So we have from Malawi a ROM. A ROM is nothing more than an empty equipment for this very solid shit which has been in the pit for years and it can't be emptied other than manual. Now if you want to empty it mechanical, it's under high pressure, it's made loose again, and then it can be sucked by a pump. And this is a very interesting proposition, because there's tremendous need for this kind of equipment, because you can't send people in everywhere, the people may not even be there all the time, and some are simply not as accessible. Now this comes indeed in this segment of the service and value chain in the collection disposal part. And what is interesting is that we find that this is a profit-making venture. Right from the word go, it was financed through some external financing, because initially no bank would go for it, but the entrepreneur today is making profit. The second one is in the reuse spheres, where we have human fecal matter and we would like to make it into a agricultural product, in this case compost. So prior to starting this, the land had to be prepared, vegetable waste had to be collected, fecal sludge was added to it. The fecal sludge started drying, then more waste was added to it, cow dung, and finally worms. And through a windrow composting process, finally we got the bags of compost. Now, if you look into the costing, the Indian rupee is about 70 rupees to euro. So the costs are quite detailed. What you find is the transportation cost of human fecal matter wasn't the major cost. The major cost is on the worms. And the total cost is 380,000, which translates to about 5,500 euros for a 10-ton human waste project. Now, I have a few questions for you. This unit is producing 4.5 tons of human waste, or of compost rather, made out of human waste. And seeing the cost, at what sales price can you make a profit? But then the second question is, this is on the costing you have seen there. Do you see ways and means to reduce the sales price, or alternatively increase your profit? And thirdly, there are in the costing overview, do you see essential costs that have not been included? So is there something in here which has not been included? Now then, let me conclude with some references on financing and further reading. The Water and Sanitation Program of the World Bank, they have a lot of micro-calculations showing very positive returns on sanitation investments. Waste, they have a number of interesting publications on financing sanitation based on practice. Susanna, the working group number 2 is on finance and economics. They post quite a number of interesting articles. IRC has a number of them. And there are at Ecosun Austria, they also have sanitation as a business financing for sanitation. So the number, and within those you'll find further references for further reading. Well, thanks very much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed it. Now, I would encourage you to look at the film These Guys Are Extremely Liquid. Be well seated. Make sure that you have nothing in your stomach which is non-digestible. and enjoy, and it's been my pleasure. Thanks.